My name's Ian Stevenson, and I'm here today to present to you my Part B presentation on the development of a rugged-plus-speed three-dimensional laser scanner. First up, I'd just like to mention that this is an industry-sponsored project, and my sponsor company was BNTWBM. They're a group of engineering consultants in Broadmeadow. Alright, so first of all, I'd just like to briefly mention three problems that I set out to address in my project. Now, the first issue is related to the insufficient spatial feedback for large-scale autonomous machinery. Now, we all know that a significant focus of mechatronics is concerned with the automation of machinery. However, in the past, the automation side of mechatronics has been largely confined to small-scale robotics in laboratories or factories. And one of the main reasons for this is that very little work has been put into the development of an off-the-shelf solution for providing advanced sensory feedback in large-scale robotics applications. Addressing this issue is the primary focus of my thesis. In addition to this, there currently exists a requirement for three-dimensional numerical measurement in operator assist applications. Now, this can be useful in the operation of cranes, drag lines, or loading of bulk carrier ships. And finally, there currently exists no permanent means of accurately measuring the volume of bulk materials in stockpiles, hoppers, and silos. Alright, so just to quickly illustrate the significance of my projects, let's just compare the dimensions, or three dimensions, of spatial feedback. So first of all, we have one-dimensional measurement. Now this just tells you the distance to a target. Very little information is given to you there. Next up, you have two-dimensional measurement. This tells you both the distance and the direction to a target, provided that your target lies within the planar detection zone of the scanner. Now, a collection of two-dimensional measurements, such as that shown here, is called a scan line. If you add a dimension to that, a three-dimensional measurement, and this tells us all the useful spatial information about the environment. This type of information is incredibly valuable in mobile autonomous machinery, and a collection of three-dimensional measurements like that shown there is called a point cloud. Now, some of you might be thinking, hang on a minute, some industrial mining machinery has already been automated, such as stackers and reclaimers. Now you'd think that their control systems must have a fairly good understanding of what's around them. So the answer in most applications is, well, no, they don't. These machines largely rely on the fact that they operate in a predetermined environment. Now with large industrial machinery operating in a world that is not void of human error, it pays to implement a few controls that allow a control system to detect the unexpected. All right, now, so let's take a look at what's already out there. Existing technologies capable of three-dimensional measurement include time-of-flight cameras, stereo vision cameras, and laser triangulation. Now, these technologies all provide fast and detailed measurements of their surroundings. However, these technologies tend to lack the required range necessary in large-scale robotics applications. Final technology capable of three-dimensional measurement are called three-dimensional laser scanners, otherwise known as three-dimensional LiDAR. Commercial three-dimensional laser scanners are also very fast and are capable of operating over a long range with exceptional resolution and accuracy. The only drawback of this technology is that many of these devices were developed for geographical surveying applications and generally very expensive and fragile. We've got two-dimensional laser scanners. Okay, so in contrast to the three-dimensional scanners, you have two-dimensional laser scanners. Now, these are far better suited to industrial environments. These are largely used in anti-collision applications on mine sites and typically come housed in IP67 rated die-cast aluminium enclosures. So how do you use... Okay, we've got two-dimensional laser scanners. They operate on the principle of taking laser distance measurements in an arc, usually between 0 and 180 degrees, although in some of the more modern applications you can actually vary this number to reduce the scanning window. So how do we use two-dimensional laser scanners for generating three-dimensional data? Well, there are two approaches. You've got transverse progressive scanning and rotational progressive scanning. To the left you see a vehicle-mounted two-dimensional laser scanner where three-dimensional measurements are acquired by taking advantage of the forward movement of the vehicle. If the vehicle was to stop, then the scanner can no longer function. In the image to the right, we have an example of a rotational progressive scanning method. In this application, the four two-dimensional laser scanners at the top of the vehicle are made to rotate in a nodding fashion. This is used to provide 3D sensory feedback for the unmanned autonomous military vehicle, affectionately named the Crusher. It's a beast. playing again. Sorry. So what did I set out to achieve in my project? Well, I decided to break the scope of my project up into two stages, to be completed in semester one and semester two. Now, the primary objective of semester one was to bring the project to a stage where all the hardware systems had been taken care of. This required investigating similar technologies, constructing and assessing a proof of concept prototype, followed by the design and construction of the final hardware solution. With the mechanical systems under control, I was able to focus my efforts in semester two on the development of the required software components. After confirming that the hardware can perform as desired, I was able to commence work on the system's main operation software, followed by the development of a demo visualization package. And after all this, the project was finalized with successful integration testing. So in my project, I've decided to adopt a rotational progressive scanning approach, where I rotate the scanning head about the vertical sweep axis illustrated here to the left. Now this results in a hemispherical detection zone illustrated by the point cloud shown to the right. Now some of you may notice that this results in a concentration of points towards the center of the scan. However, this effect is really unavoidable in any rotational scanning approach. In fact, in this application, I'm actually able to use it to my advantage because it allows me to point the scan towards targets of interest for enhanced resolution. So using this approach, a proof of concept prototype was developed, and as illustrated here, shown installed directly above a coal surge bin at a local coal handling facility. The purpose of this device was to learn about the operation of a two-dimensional laser scanner and to validate the scanning concept, and basically just to make sure that the scanner can actually detect coal. Now, the two-dimensional laser scanner is located underneath the stainless steel enclosure shown there, and inside the box is a Panasonic top-up computer running basic method acquisition software. So here we have an animation showing a record of three-dimensional scans taken at the surge bin over a three-hour period. These scans were recorded at three-minute intervals, and I'm playing them back to you here at 10 frames per second. Now it's important to remember that these are not just images that you're looking at here. Each frame of this video represents a consolidation of over 130,000 laser measurements, all defined by XYZ coordinates in three-dimensional space. The scanning system was installed there and was found to operate reliably for, I think it was about 3 weeks before we decommissioned it. And because these measurements are all defined by real coordinates, this makes point-to-point measurement easy. Here I've written a program that measures the difference in coal heights inside the coal surge bin. The image to the left of the point cloud shows an image of the surge bin taken from the perspective of the laser scanner. And I think the relative difference in detail between those two images is fairly self-evident. Following the success of the prototype, I was then able to take what I learned from that and commence work on the final design. After 12 iterations of concept designs, I was finally satisfied with one solution that ticked all the right boxes. I then approached a local engineering works with a full set of technical drawings and kicked off the 4-week process of manufacturing the device you see to the left. This concept was chosen for its elegantly simple design. With only a handful of moving parts, this design features the least number of possible modes of failure and is expected to operate reliably in most industrial environments. Some of the major components of this system include a spun aluminium enclosure with a top half enclosing a sealed section, an 8-pin mercury bar slip ring, a stainless steel drive shaft that also serves as a mounting hub, a sensor for detecting the top dead center position of the scanner's drive system, a smooth low backlash timing belt drive system, an integrated stepper driver circuit card, an IP54 sealed stepper motor, and finally a SIG LMS291 laser scanning head. And that's really the heart of the system. And weighs only 14.5 kilograms. By securing the mounting hub to a rigid structure, the device can be made to continuously rotate, while also passing information to and from the rest of the scanning system. Software running on board the industrial computer illustrated to the left is designed to orchestrate the operation of the scanning system and is also capable of interpreting scan information relative to a static reference frame. Information produced by the scanning system is then stored locally on the industrial computer and is made accessible for use via a LAN, Wi-Fi, or 3G connection. This can be accessed via a remote terminal or a control system. Now, one of the key functional requirements of my scanning system is its ability to generate a static map of its environment, regardless of how the scanner itself is moving. In order to evaluate this aspect of the project, it was decided to install my scanning system on a large mobile coal reclaimer. Here, the scanning system was required to produce coherent scans of a coal stockpile while operating from a moving platform. And here we have a wider angle shot of the machine that my scanner was tested on. And just to give you guys an understanding of the shear enormity of this machine, that's my laser scanner mounted just down there. All right, and this is an example of what I got from my testing. This image represents the accumulation of several three-dimensional scans of the coal stockpile during reclaiming operations. Now, this data was cropped in each of the three axes before being surfaced and coloured with respect to height. I had to crop the data to be able to remove any machine infrastructure and any jump off in the distance. Now, as you can see, there's very little distortion in the acquired measurements, even despite the fact that the scanner is continuously moving during acquisition. Now, this was made possible through the use of an efficient 6-degree of freedom kinematic transformation algorithm. In addition to the scanning system, the scope of my project also called for the development of simple means of visualizing three-dimensional data. Here it was decided to develop this package as a compiled MATLAB graphical user interface. This application allows the user to browse any local or network file directory and illustrate the scan files and illustrate their contents here in the center as a three-dimensional point cloud. Now, some of you may recognize this particular scan as the University of Newcastle's nursing theater. In this example, I've used the controls at the top right-hand corner of the form to trim the data in the vertical axis so as to remove any data points defining the roof of the building. And the five controls at the bottom of the form here allow the user to manipulate how the information is viewed while also allowing point-to-point measurement. In addition to the scope of the project, we also developed software for visualizing point cloud data using four other methods. The first of these include an application that allowed the output of the scanner to be viewed in real time. Now, the intention of this was for the software to act like a three-dimensional radar plot. I also developed software for visualizing point cloud data as a colored surface plot, a colored point cloud, as well as a three-dimensional stereoscopic image or stereoscopic animation. And of course, this requires the user to wear three-dimensional glasses. Sorry, guys. The scanning system developed in this project has paved the way for an assortment of future work and, of course, systems enhancements. The first of these system enhancements include a scanning technique which I've called scan interlacing. So one of the issues with the current method of scanning is that depending on the desired resolution, it may take several seconds before a full point cloud can be developed. Now, in highly dynamic applications, it's possible that this delay may result in machine collision if an obstruction isn't detected in time. So later on in the project, it was discovered that the rotation of the scanning head could be increased and the acquired scan lines could be interlaced over several rotations of the scanning head. And this allows the scanning system to quickly develop a coarse map of its environment with its resolution steadily increasing as time goes by. This results in the same number of points in the same time. It's just you get a better understanding of what's around you quickly. So after all this, I plan to investigate a three-dimensional grid occupancy mapping technique before implementing a simultaneous localization and mapping algorithm. Following this work, I hope to implement this system in two operator assist applications. The first providing three-dimensional numerical feedback for an operator, providing access to real-time three-dimensional measurements. After that, an assistant can be enhanced to generate high-level command instructions, such as move left, move right, accelerate, etc. Once the system is proven to operate reliably in this role, we'll then look at the possibility of machine automation. So just to summarize, in this project I've successfully developed a rugged three-dimensional laser scanning system, and this has been demonstrated to operate effectively in both dynamic and static applications. I believe that the work carried out in this project has served as a vital step towards large-scale machine automation and has recently opened the door to a variety of future work. In addition to this, my sponsoring company has also received numerous expressions of interest in this project from coal handling facilities throughout Australia, and just recently it's allowed me to secure a more permanent position within the company. Thank you very much for your attention, guys. And I'll take any questions that you might have.
A two-part question for you is, was dust ever an issue in any of the testing? If dust was an issue, how did your software deal with that?
Okay, so the optic LMS-291 laser scanner has a certain immunity to dust and fog. Basically, that's something which scanning system really needs to rely on. That sort of technology is fairly common amongst two-dimensional laser scanners, so it's really not an issue that I have to deal with. I haven't had an issue with dust or fog in any tests that I've done. However, something that I have known is that with dark materials such as coal, they tend to absorb the laser beam, and it's a lot harder for the sensor to actually detect any information from a long distance. So the scanning system has a range of 80 meters for generally reflective materials like the things you see around you. But for dark objects such as coal, it's reduced down to about a range of 30 meters. So dust hasn't really caused an issue yet. No. Anyone else?
Just wondering, with the profiling of your stockpiles, are you able to determine tonnages contained on the stockpiles?
Absolutely. That's one of the applications of the scanning system. So for monitoring the volume of bulk materials and using the bulk density of the material that you're scanning, you can theoretically determine tonnages, yes. So yeah, there's just a little bit of data analysis required there for integration underneath the surface. Anyone else?
Any further questions? Another interesting topic. Thank you, Ed.
Thank you very much.